Hello friends, welcome to Seiko Psycho. In this video, we're going to learn operate conditioning, how it really operates. Introduction. Well, classical conditioning involves the learning of involuntary automatic responses. Operate conditioning is about how organisms learn voluntary responses. Operate conditioning is based on the research of Edward L. Thorndike and B.F. Skinner. They want to make our behavior as voluntary rather than automatic or involuntary responses. So whatever you behavior, it should have certain reason for the behavior. So for this only, Edward L. Thorndike conducted an experiment on cats. So Thorndike, he did research on a cat based on the consequence or response experiment rather stimulus type. Thorndike placed a hungry cat inside a puzzle box from which the only escape was to press a lever. Located on the floor of the box, Thorndike placed a dish of food outside the box so the hungry cat is highly motivated to get out, and he observed that the cat would move around the box, pushing and rubbing up against the walls in an effort to escape. Eventually, the cat would accidentally push the lever, opening the door. Upon escaping, the cat was fed from a dish placed just outside the box. The lever is the stimulus, the pushing of the lever is the response, and the consequence is both escape good and the food even better. The cat did not learn to push the lever and escape right away. After a number of trials and many errors in a box like this one, the cat took less and less time to push the lever that would open the door. It's important not to assume that the cat has figured out the connection between the lever and freedom. Thorndike kept moving the lever to a different position and the cat had learned the whole process over again. The cat would simply continue to rub and push in the same general area that led to food and freedom the last time, each time getting out and fed a little more quickly. Based on this research, Thorndike developed the law of effect. If an action is followed by pleasurable consequence, it will tend to be repeated. If an action is followed by an unpleasant consequence, it will tend not to be repeated. This is basic principle behind learning voluntary behavior. So B.F. Skinner, the behaviorist. So B.F. Skinner is a person who championed the behavioristic model. In addition to his knowledge of prevalent classical conditions, Skinner found in the work of Thorndike a way to explain all behavior as a product of learning. He even gave the learning of voluntary behavior a special name, operate condition. So the term operate condition was first given by B.F. Skinner. Voluntary behavior is what people and animals do to operate in the world. So voluntary behavior for Skinner is operate behavior, and the learning of such behavior is operate conditioning. So basically, the response depends on the unconscious stimulus and what will become the conditional stimulus. But in Skinner model, these two stimulus are the antecedent stimulus. Antecedent means something that comes before another thing. But in operate conditioning, learning depends on what happens after the response, the consequences. So classical condition is focusing on antecedent, and operate condition is focusing on consequences. The concept of reinforcement. So reinforcement may any event or stimulus that when following a response increase the probability that the response will occur again. Reinforces any event or objects that when following a response increase the likelihood of that response occurring again. Primary reinforces any responses that is naturally reinforcing by meeting a basic biological need such as hunger, thirst or touch. Whereas secondary reinforces that becomes reinforcing after paired with the primary reinforce such as praise, tokens or gold stars. So if it is a small example of to how to derive the primary reinforces to the secondary reinforces. Let's say that a friend of yours asks you to help her move some books from the trunk of her car to her apartment on the second floor. She offers you a choice of $25 or a candy bar. Unless you have suffered recent brain damage, you will most likely choose the money, right? With $25, you could buy more than one candy bar. Now pretend that your friend offers the same deal to a 3-year-old child who lives downstairs for carrying up some of the paperbacks, books, $25 or candy bar. Which reward will the child more likely to choose? Most children at this age have no real idea of the value of money, so the child will probably choose the candy bar. The money and the candy bar represent two basic kinds of reinforcers, items, or events that when following a response will strengthen it. A reinforcer such as a candy bar that fulfills a basic needs like hunger is called primary reinforcers. Examples would be any kind of food, hunger drive, liquid, or touch. Infant, toddlers, preschool age children, and animals can be easily reinforced by using primary reinforcers. Freedom from pain is also a basic need, so pain itself can be a primary reinforcer when it is removed. Removal of a painful stimulus fills a basic need just as eating food when hungry fills the hunger need. A secondary reinforcer such as money, however, gets its reinforcing properties from being associated with the primary reinforcers in the past. A child who is given money to spend such soon realizes that the ugly green paper can be traded for candy and treats primary reinforcers, and so money becomes reinforcing in and itself. If a person praises a puppy while petting him, the praise alone will eventually make the puppy scream with delight. The neural basis of learning. One important area involved in the learning consists of neurons in anterior cingulate cortex, that is ACC, located in the frontal lobe above the front by the corpus callosum. This corpus callosum will unite the right and left hemisphere of brain. The ACC, that is anterior cingulate cortex, also connects nucleus accumbens, which is a pathway and involved in dopamine. Basically, dopamine is a pleasure hormone which is released, which makes you feel good. So this neural basis of learning plays a key role in learning and to do the action repeatedly because you are feeling that due to this of this dopamine activity. So types of reinforcement. So basically there are four types of reinforcement: positive, negative, partial, and continuous. Positive reinforcement, the reinforcement of a response by the addition or experiencing of a pleasurable stimulus. For example, a child has got candy. It's a positive reinforcement. Negative reinforcement, the reinforcement of a response by the removal, escape from, or avoidance of an unpleasant stimulus. If you, for example, if you don't study properly, you need to wash the dishes for a month. So to escape from or avoid that unpleasant stimulus, the person is studying well. It's a negative reinforcement. Partial reinforcement effect is a tendency for a response that is reinforced after the same, but not all. Corrective responses to be very resistant to extinction. And continuous reinforcement, the reinforcement of each and every corrective response. Basically, partial reinforcement effect only having a long-lasting effect than the continuous reinforcement, because partial reinforcement gives you reward after certain reinforcement, but it is not known you whether you are making correct responses or not, and it has a resistance for the extinction. Whereas continuous reinforcement, you are getting to know that you are doing the correct things and you are rewarding for every correct responses. There's a chances of extinction for the correct reinforcement, whereas partial reinforcement, it has less chances for it. So these are the skill response behavior and time interval. This table is showing about the four types of interval schedules of reinforcement and variable schedule of reinforcement, and how these four will differ our operates in our behavior. When the timing of the response is more important, it is called interval schedule. When it is a number of responses that is important, the schedule is called ratio schedule, because a certain number of responses is required for each reinforcer to get the pleasure, to get the reinforcement, or to get the reward from it. The first one is a fixed interval schedule of a reinforcement. If you take the fixed ratio a schedule of reinforcement. Reinforcement provided after a specific number of responses. Example, when the toddler turns the page in a book every time or every third time. Whereas fixed time interval, a schedule of reinforcement. Reinforcement provided after specific length of time. After 2 minutes of toddler sitting quietly in the car seat. If you take variable, the variable changes from, variable is nothing but anything which changes. So variable interval schedule of reinforcement provided after average number of responses. When the toddler turns the page in a book, mom raises verbally about every 4 to 6 pages turn. Whereas variable time interval schedule, which is a reinforcement provided after an average amount of time. After about every 2 to 5 minutes of the toddler sitting, quiet in the car seat. Basically, these variables may vary from every experimentation, but fixed reinforcement or fixed time interval is always fixed, the number of responses or the time. And the best example for variable ratio schedule of reinforcement is lottery tickets. Buying lottery ticket is much the same thing as is any kind of gambling. People don't know how many tickets they will have to buy, and they are afraid that if they don't buy the next one, that will be the ticket that would have won. So they keep buying and buying. Whereas a variable interval schedule reinforcement, dialing a busy phone number is also this kind of schedule, as people don't know when the call will get through. So they keep dialing and dialing. And the fixed ratio schedule reinforcement best example is like punches. When the card has 10 punches, for example, the customer might get a free sandwich. So there's a fixed ratio. And the best example for fixed interval schedule of reinforcement is like a examination. A fixed interval schedule would be the way that many people floss and brush the teeth more rigorously for a few days before the next dental exam, especially those who have not been flossing until just before their appointment. In this case, they are probably hoping for native reinforcement. The cleaner they get their teeth before the appointment, the less time they might have to spend it at a chair. So these are the very general examples in our daily life. To take the difference between the classical condition operate conditioning, the response in a classical condition is very involuntary and automatic. It is totally reflex. Whereas operate condition, it is a voluntary, it is learned, it is operates based on environment reward, like a positive reinforcement or negative reinforcement. Extinction, condition response that decreases with when a condition stimulus is repeatedly presented along. Response decreases when reinforcement stops, either it may be negative or positive. Cognitive processes, organisms develop expectation that cognitive stimulus signals the arrival of unconditioned stimulus. Here, CS, that conditional stimulus, which plays a key role to condition the behavior after getting the unconditioned stimulus. That cognition, the thinking, is related to the conditioned stimulus and unconditioned stimulus. Whereas in operant condition, organism develop expectation that a response will be reinforced or punished. They also exhibit latent learning without reinforcement. So once you learn something, it is again responded in a future way of challenging. It is latent. It is like applied in a future type of learning. So take a biological predisposition. Natural predisposition is constant. What stimuli and responses can easily be associated. Whereas in operant conditioning, organisms best learn behavior similar to their natural behaviors. Unnatural behaviors instinctively drift back towards natural ones. So both condition, that may be classical or operative condition, they couldn't make any change for a biological predisposition or a instinctual drift. So there's lots of difference between punishment and reinforcement. Punishment, any event or object that when following a response makes that response less likely to happen again. Whereas reinforcement is like you're making more action to do again and again. Whereas punishment, it is a constant. You are avoiding that response by placing anything which may call a punishment. So punishment by application, the punishment of a response by the addition or experiencing of unpleasant stimulus. The best example of punishment of applications like when a child is doing something bad, you're just spanking at his back, and you're just beating, or you're just making him to sit for 1 hour in his room. This is a punishment of application. Punishment by removal, the punishment of a response by the removal of pleasurable stimulus. For example, you just punish your child not to watch the television for 1 week. You just punish your child not to get ice creams for 1 month. You just punish your child not to play with his friends for 1 month because he failed in examinations. Here in the reinforcement, positive reinforce is a key. It's a key way to make a healthy operant conditioning. In punishment, punishment by removal is a good way of removing of pleasurable negative actions or negative responses. Because if you take punishment by application, just you're sparking at the back of a child, or you're just punishing him with a verbal or a physical form, may result in maladaptive behavior or some sort of aggression, inward or outward. Whereas punishment by removal, it's yes, you're just removing the pleasurable stimulus, which makes him to know that doing a certain actions may result in to get away from pleasurable stimulus. So he may stop doing that response or doing that actions. So it is a simple way to understand reinforcement versus punishment. Reinforcement is a positive and negative, they are both. A stimulus is presented, a stimulus is removed, a negative stimulus. Whereas positive punishments, a stimulus is presented, and in negative punishment, a stimulus is removed. In both reinforcement, that is positive and negative reinforcement, behavior is increasing in both cases. Whether there is a negative reinforcement, or you want to get rid of the stimulus, or a positive reinforcement when you want to get that stimulus. Whereas in positive punishment or negative punishment, you are both the behavior are decreasing. You are avoiding that behavior. So here the stimulus is presented, which is applied, whereas in negative punishment, where you are making to punishment by removal the pleasurable things. So there are other concepts which are same with the classical condition theory and operant condition theory, that are discriminative stimulus, extinction, generalization, spontaneous recovery. Discriminative stimulus, where any stimulus is such as a stop sign that provides the organism with a cue for making certain response in order to obtain reinforcement. Extinction is nothing but if you remove the reinforcement, either positive or negative, the behavior that operants are extincted after a period of time. Generalization is like when you're giving the reinforcement for a particular behavior, person or organism gets a reinforcement which gets into generalization. For example, if you're just giving a candy for getting good grades in examination, the papa is like a other friend is giving a small biscuit or something like a small toy, it is a generalized reward. It's a generalized reward for the consequences he has performed well in examination. So spontaneous recovery, where even though you stop giving reinforcement after some time, that same behavior is repeated without any difficulty. So applications. Whereas classical condition theory is applied in emotional conditioning and to advertise and to get rid of drugs through aversion technique. Whereas in application part of operant conditioning, you're using the shaping. Shaping the reinforcement of a simple steps in behavior through successive approximation that lead to desired more complex behavior. So shaping is done in schools, college, in schools, primary schools, upper primary schools, and with the parents also, where there is a successive approximation of the rewards or reinforcement to lead to a desired and more complex behavior. So when you see an animal in a circus or in a show or at a zoo perform tricks, you are seeing the result of applying the rules of condition, both classical and operant to animals. But the more complex tricks are the process in operant conditioning called shaping, in which small steps towards some ultimate goals are reinforced until goal itself achieved. So your successive approximation is nothing but small steps, one after the other, that get closer and closer to the goal. And if we take the behavioral modification, which was placed a key role in a behavioral approach in a counseling application, the use of learned technique to modify or change undesirable behavior and increase desired behavior. It includes token economy, which is applied in schizophrenia type of patients, and applied behavior analysis, that is ABA, for curing autism. So token economy is one of the strategy, the use of objects called tokens to reinforce behavior in which the tokens can accumulate and exchange for desired items or privileges. So in the, for example, the child is collecting gold star to buy the special treat at the end of the day. So it is one of the examples for token economy. And whereas ABA is a applied behavior analysis, is a modern term for a form of behavior modification that uses both analysis of current behavior and behavior technique to address a socially relevant issue. In ABA, skills are broken down to the simplest steps and then taught to the child through a system of reinforcement. Prompts such as moving child's face back to look at the teachers or the task are given as needed when a child is learning a skill or refuses to cooperate. As a child begins to master a skill and receives reinforcement in the form of treats or praise, the prompts are gradually withdrawn until a child can do the skill independently. Applied behavior analysis is a growing field with many colleges and universities offering degree at both undergraduate and graduation levels. Typical uses of ABA are treating children with disorders, training animals, and developing effective teaching methods for children and adults of all levels of mental abilities. An example of how ABA can be used is found in the use of shaping to mold desirable, socially acceptable behavior in individuals with autism. Autism is a disorder in which the person has greatly difficulty in communicating with others, often refusing to look at another person. People who have autism may also fail to learn to speak at all, and they normally do not like to be touched. This specific application of ABA, that is applied behavior analysis, can be said to have begun with the work of Dr. O. Ivara Lovai and his associate, although the basic general technique are those for Otlander Skinner. Lovai used small piece of candy as a reinforcer to teach social skills and language to children with autism. And the biofeedback, it's a relatively newer biofeedback technique called neurofeedback. So take what is a biofeedback. It's a traditional term used to describe the kind of biological feedback of information, and through its use, many problems can be relieved or controlled. And if you take neurofeedback, you're using your electrical activity of a brain by using the EEG. So to record the EEG, a person would have to connect it to a stand-alone electroencephalography, a machine that amplifies and records the brain's electrical activity. Modern biofeedback and neurofeedback amplifiers are often connected by computer that records and analyzes the physiological activity of the brain. Neurofeedback can be integrated with a video game-like program that individuals can use to learn how to produce brain waves or specific waves of brain activity associated with a specific cognitive or behavioral states. For example, increased attention, staying focused, or relaxed awareness. Neurofeedback using the EEG, electroencephalography, continues to be investigated in specific disorders such as attention deficit hyperactive syndrome, that is ADHD, and in new areas as a control of chronic pain and the treatment of epilepsy. Other recent neurofeedback studies have incorporated in MRI or fMRI, functional magnetoresonance, to examine the effects of EEG based neurofeedback to the brain. So both fMRI, EEG, and these sort of machines which are used in functioning structure brain study, I've been explained in another video. You can watch it also. It is very useful to know how it is used and what are the uses of these things and what are the limitations of each machine. So biological constructs on operating condition. There was a person called Keller and Marion Breland, which is raccoon experiment. Raccoons commonly dunk their food in and out of water before eating. This washing behavior is controlled by instinct and difficult to change even using appropriate technique. So it is nothing but instinctive drift, tendency for an animal behavior to revert to genetically controlled patterns. Even though you apply appropriate condition or classical condition, there are certain ways you can't get rid of it. So this instinctive drift will make you to condition to do the activity again and again because it is present in our instincts. So the animals doesn't come to the lab to double dressage, that is a black state, and cannot be taught just any behavior because they have certain instincts too. Difference between species of animals matter in determining what behavior can or cannot be conditioned. It doesn't mean that all animals can be conditioned. There are certain species where you can't be conditioned. And not all responses are equally able to be conditioned to any stimulus. Due to enigmatic brain functioning, it's a different way of condition, different way of responses which are given from the conditions. So that's all, friends. If you have any doubts in operate condition, you can comment it. And thank you for watching.